Warning, do not listen to this podcast if hearing about freedom and liberty is not legal for you in your community. And if so, you should immediately move to a hipper community.
Welcome to the Freedom FEENS Podcast, a weekly web lab where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi cover the punk rockinist, hip-hopinist current events, as well as timeless universal truths about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because there's no such thing as half-free. The Freedom FEENS Podcast, available from freedomfeens.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by Alterati.com, the Micro Effect Radio Network at themicroeffect.com, and the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm.
Welcome to the Vaporsmith's Freedom Hour with Freedom Fiends, Michael W. Dean.
Broadcasting from my windowless bunker.
And Neema Vedadi.
Go, go, Freedom Fiends!
Rolling! What it do, Freedom Fiend, Michael Dean?
Hey, Neema Fiend. Go, go, Freedom Neem. So, what'd you do last night? What'd we put on the cast?
I interviewed Robin Kerner. Great guy. Started BlueRepublican.org. Writes for the Huffington Post, but he's a good guy. He's our sleeper cell there in the Huffington
Explain
Post.
Explain that. How did he get a job at the HuffPo is what I want to know.
That's a good question. Yeah, he wants to do an interview again, and maybe that'll be one of the ways we start off. But he was very excited. He said, you know, it was a great thing that he got his post at the Huffington Post so he could sort of talk to the left and try to make them remember their classical liberal sensibilities, you know, because liberal used to mean freedom. It derives from liberty. It used to mean people who, you know, wanted to be left alone. And then when they got co-opted by progressives with a hint of Marxism, they decided they could use the government to force people to do all the right things. And that was just a huge departure from classical liberalism, basically the opposite. Robin Kerner, he's a very educated guy. He's got like master's degrees.
From Cambridge University.
Yeah. Super smart guy. And it was just a pleasure to talk to him. The episode, I mean, ostensibly it's about, you know, his work on pushing the Ron Paul campaign, but it gets a lot deeper philosophically than that. It's not.
Yeah. I mean, I've actually posted it around a bunch on Facebook and gotten kind of bashed on it by my non-voting anarchist friends who are like, why would I want to look at this? And my like blue Democrat far leftist friends who hate Ron Paul are like, why would I want to look at this? And I'm like, seriously, listen to it. Even if you hate Ron Paul, it's about far more than Ron Paul. It's just a great interview.
Yes. And not only that, but, you know, this distaste for Ron Paul and elections. I mean, even if you are a non-voting anarchist or an anarchist who's going to vote for Ron Paul like me and you, it's important to note that Ron Paul represents more than just an election. He represents more than just the normal American political cycle. He represents, you know, and this is what me and Kerner talk about, and other people have talked about this, like Brent Badowski of The Hill. There's really a phase change going on. I mean, you see things like Occupy Wall Street, the Tea Party, the Arab Spring, the people who aren't part of government, you know, the regular the people, the 99% who aren't in the government and don't get the government favors are really sick. They're fed up with it. And Ron Paul is sort of a representation of that, that people are fed up with the status quo.
Well, interestingly, two of the really, really smart people that are pushing for Ron Paul right now, and they're surprising people for it, one's British and one's Canadian. I mean, Robin is in the process of becoming an American citizen, I believe, but he's British. Mm-hmm. And our friend up in Canada, Stefan Molyneux, who, interestingly, he's been railing on people who vote for Ron Paul, and his fans have taken me to task, like, damn Paulites, stay off this page. And the other day, he did like a 20-minute video speech on YouTube telling people why they should be out getting people to vote for Ron Paul.
I saw that you posted that. I didn't watch it. It was really interesting. I was listening to one of his call-in shows. He does a Sunday call-in show. And somebody called in and he was like, yeah, you know, I don't want Ron Paul to win because I think it'll discredit libertarianism and yada yada. But, you know, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm just wrong on this. And I'd hope I am. I hope Ron Paul does get elected and starts to tear down the state was basically his statement. And maybe he's realized that, hey, maybe that's more of a possibility than I thought initially.
Well, I'm going to make a prediction right now. We've talked about this before, but I'm going to like lay it down historically. When Ron Paul is done with politics, which will probably either be after this election if he doesn't win, and you know, I'm not saying he's unelectable anymore. I'm not counting on him winning or going to cry if he doesn't, but I'm going to say it's possible. But either after this election or if he becomes president after his first or second term when he's 108, like Mr. Burns, I think he's going to come out basically as a full-on anarchist because I think he's there now from some of the things he said.
I do too. I think him and maybe even Judge Napolitano.
No. He's still a Constitution humper, and I watched, and I love him. He's my favorite Constitution humper, one of them, him and Sheriff Mack and a few other people. But I saw him last night on The Daily Show.
Oh, yeah, he was on The Daily Show again.
Pimping for Ron Paul and getting the audience to cheer, we want individual liberty and the government out of our lives.
Really?
Which is impossible on The Daily Show.
Yeah.
And he tried to get Jon Stewart to agree with it of, you know, we want the government out of our lives. And he's like, you agree with me, right, Jon? And he's like, no, I really don't. But for some reason, I want to come over and hug you right now. but, I mean, he was even, Judge Napolitano even differentiated himself from Ron Paul, saying, I'm a strict constitutionalist and he just wants to tear down the whole thing. Mm-hmm. Which was interesting because they're friends and they're close and they know each other's stuff. And he basically said, Ron Paul's an anarchist, I'm a constitutionalist, without using those words.
I think Ron Paul wants to tear it down. I hope he tear it down. I hope he's the American Gorbachev, and you know he oversees the dismantling of the American empire, and we tear down this status wall that has been blocking all the individuals from living their lives.
So you know what the name of this episode is?
No.
It's Liberty, Equality, Brotherhood, and Spying. Do you know what that's about?
I know that you can't have those four things all at once.
Well, there's a French slogan. I don't know if it's a slogan of France or just a slogan from France that is everywhere in France, you know, carved into the side of buildings. I can't really pronounce it, but it's like Liberté, Égalité, Fraternité or something. Uh-huh. And I have this picture I found somewhere of in France, those, and it means, you know, liberty, equality, and brotherhood. And there's a picture of those carved into the side of some government building in France. And there's a security camera looking down right next to it, like into the rock it's carved in. And that's going to be the picture for this cast.
Of course. Okay. Good. I dig it. Another point I wanted to make about Ron Paul, and this was kind of funny, actually. John Bolton, if you know him, he was a UN ambassador in the Bush administration. Just evil warmonger, as statist as you can get. He got this goofy mustache. Looks like he just wants to beat some kids with his fists. he actually came out and said that he would consider working in a Ron Paul administration. First of all, as if Ron Paul would have him.
He's a carpetbagger.
He's a carpetbagger, yeah. And he basically clarified that and said, so that I could make sure we were posturing in foreign policy the correct way.
Well, he needs a job. He's just trying to be a state. Right now, he's just on every talk show and every news, fake news talk show and real news
but
talk
I thought
show.
Of it as sort of a freedom fix because somebody like John Bolton is going to say something like that. It means he actually might think Ron Paul can win.
I actually heard Glenn Beck almost endorsing Ron Paul, which, you know, probably would disendorse him to a lot of people. But I think Glenn Beck is leaning more anarchist or pure constitutionalist of like, I mean, basically his thing is he fucking hates
the Fed.
No, he hates the fucking Fed. He does. He fucking hates Newt Gingrich. He said on his radio show the other day, I was watching on YouTube, you know, first of all, it's like he's out of under the corporate masters of Fox and he's on this radio show, which does have advertisers, but he can speak his mind more. And smart Republicans become leading down to anarchists. We've said that before. And he's basically like, okay, the economy's in danger of collapsing. When that happens, if the president is a progressive liberal, we're going to end up with communism. If he's a progressive right winger, like
Newt Gingrich, Rick Santorum, John Huntsman,
we're going to end up with fascism.
End up? We're already there, but
no, we're not. We're talking right now. If this was truly fascism, there'd be a f***ing knock at our door and we'd be dragged off.
Well, it's soft fascism. I mean, all fascism is defined by is the big corporate interest and the state basically controlling everything. And that's what we have now. They let us have our little freedoms. And like Stefan Molyneux says, it's mostly just to keep us productive so that they have more money to tax us.
Well, if everybody's in jail, nobody can make any money.
Exactly. Exactly.
Somebody has to pay for the jail and the jailers and the cops. But
So it's a softer, more self-aware fascism, but I still think it's fascism nonetheless.
Well, I mean, the term fascism is misused. I mean, when people scream it at politicians, no matter what their flavor of tyranny is, they'll call them fascism, when it's really a specific type of tyranny. And it's not even – it is always tyrannical, but – people say it as if it's interchangeable with tyrant, or really often with you don't want to enforce the laws I want to enforce.
Right. Well, I rarely ever see Glenn Beck, but I will give him this to his credit. He had Santorum on his show, and he said basically, you had me at hello, you know, reference to Jerry Maguire, and then he was like, but tell me about the Fed. And then Santorum spouted off some boilerplate about how the Fed keeps us all prosperous. And Beck was like, oh, you lost me. He just said it straight up.
As soon as Glenn Beck discovered the Fed and started bashing it, he got kicked off of Fox.
Yeah, he did. He did. And Santorum, I hate him with all I have, but I do admire at least his honesty. You know, he's not going to go up there and talk about freedom and then not give it. He did this interview. They've been playing it lately. It's been making all the freedom media, where he basically says, you know, what I really don't like is this libertarian-ish republicanism, where, you know, you think that people can do what they want and the government should be out of our bedrooms and we should have low taxes and there shouldn't be regulations. He basically just showed his hand.
He said in one of the debates last week to Ron Paul, he turned to Ron Paul and said, well, I'm not a libertarian, Ron. I believe in some government, basically calling Ron Paul an anarchist. And, you know, it's interesting to me that the whole Tea Party thing basically started with Ron Paul supporters having a tax day protest about 3 years ago on April 15th. And it got co-opted by Fox and by, you know, I don't even know the names of the groups, you do, but a bunch of right-wingers. And it turned into this thing that was basically all of the moral majority types, like Santorum, you know, the people who want to be in our bedrooms watching us with, I don't know why, but...
you know why.
yeah, scratch a homophobe. Creepy. But none of that was in those Tea Party events basically organized by Fox and Glenn Beck, the massive ones all over the country. There was no talk of social issues. It was all economic. Mm-hmm. And then when it turns around to election time, those people are rolling out their moral majority, crush the homos, crush the single mothers and damn them to hell and... Yeah.
Who didn't vote for the Save a Marriage Act or whatever it is, or who didn't sign this pledge to save marriage? Ron Paul. And it's like, really? You want the government to regulate marriage?
They're progressives, man. They're right-wing progressives. They are exactly like Danny Democrats, like Nancy Pelosi. And I wouldn't even say 180 degrees away, because like Robin said in that interview, and you said, they agree on the worst shit. They agree on bombing everybody, policing the world, printing money like it's candy, controlling everyone's lives, reading their email, you know, having a cop on every corner, and, you know, celebrating New Year's by partying and dancing in the street while there's a f***ing sniper looking at you through his coat.
Speaking of that, that brings us back to Glenn Beck. I'll believe Glenn Beck as a good anarchist when he stops being a foreign policy hawk, when he stops being an Israel humper.
Basically, what he said in his interview was, I would back Ron Paul if he were stronger on military. You know, if he would kill more brown people. But
it's such a red herring, though, because Ron Paul never says we shouldn't have a military. You know, I disagree with that personally. I don't know what defense should look like in LibPair necessarily. I know it should not resemble in any way the way our military or our standing army looks now. But I do know that Glenn Beck is an Israel firster. He wants America to have troops in the Middle East and have a big footprint just to protect Israel.
Did you know a bunch of American troops were just sent over to Israel?
Really?
Yeah, like being stationed there, like in case. I don't know what, but yeah.
Yikes.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast. Freedom Fiends is now available for 24/7 streaming to your iPhone, Android phone, or other chromed robot turd. Click on the streaming audio link on freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
So sorry I didn't laugh at any of your jokes on the last episode. I had postpartum depression from having done and edited my SEO podcast the day before. I was burnt.
I didn't even notice, and I don't make my jokes to get laughter. I make my jokes because they make me feel happy. And if I get laughs, then good. If not, then not.
So I have a couple follow-ups from last week. It was Mr. Abstracto, not Jason, who said the lines about the government staying out of our zeros and ones on our hard drive.
Ah, I do love that line.
We have our Shrine of Feline listeners now on the Freedom Fiends Fun Forum. So upload pictures of you listening to Freedom Fiends, or you know, showing the website, or showing a T-shirt, or holding up a piece of paper while hanging out with your cats, dogs, marmots, antelope, whatever pet you have,
skunks, porcupines,
hedgehogs,
all of them. Yeah, I assigned that task to my wife. I told her to go ahead and take pictures of the cats and the dogs and get us going. Freedom Fiends stuff.
Doesn't necessarily have to be with you. I mean, I posted a picture of Peanut looking like he's editing the podcast on the computer, but
there you go.
Basically, all of our cats have this thing called an ass vacuum, which is if we get out of a chair or a couch for like 2 seconds, they jump up in it. The right. Ass vacuum right. Sucks
they,
them
they
in.
Feel the vacuum. Yeah, yeah. My dog does that with the bed. My dog will not lay on the bed. We have a king-size bed. It could fit like 10 dogs in me and my wife. But my dog will not lay on it if both of us are on it. As soon as one of us gets off, he's like there immediately. It is exactly like the ass vacuum.
I'm sucking on a Vaporsmith electronic cigarette, one of the new extra, extra strength nicotine.
You're a nicotine fiend, Michael.
I am, man.
This
is like drugs. I love it. Be careful. But check them out. The extra highs are amazing.
I do not have any extra highs yet. I'm puffing on a Classics full
You're not old enough. You're not old enough. It's not for people under 40. You're not mature enough yet to handle
it. It's like ultra porn.
Yeah, it's ultra porn. Ultra porn is for people that are over 40.
Yeah.
So we have a really good comment from a hardcore Christian lady on TalkStreamLive.com, which is one of the places we're syndicated.
All right.
Beth Smart said, "Your program is very informative, and y'all do a good job, a very good job at bringing the happenings of what is going on in this earthly world of evil. A very down-to-earth program. Thanks. God bless y'all."
Nice. It is uniting. An earthly world of evil. Very, very observant there, Beth.
It is. You know, even my secular libertarian view of the world is there's just some pure evil in it, and it's prevalent.
Yes. Well, I was listening to Bad Quaker. He brings up a good point that I think all Christians, evangelicals around the country should take into consideration, that worshiping the flag, worshiping the state is idolatry.
I took it further of the thing he said after that, and it's my sig line on the Freedom Fiends Fun Forum, is putting the state first is kicking God off the throne.
Yeah. It is. It really is despicable. We've talked about this before, of people, families who love the state more than they love their own children.
Yeah.
You know, they're willing to send their kids off to die for the glory of the people in Washington, for the glory of Nancy Pelosi, for the glory of Barack Obama. No problem with that. You know, you should love your kids. You should love your family more than that.
You know, I mean, in Vietnam, a lot of protesters actually brought up, you're going off to die for Wall Street.
Yeah.
That's not a new thought, man.
Right. But I think it's important to bring up again because people, certain people, and I don't think it's all Christians, I don't think it's all evangelicals, but some of them think that it's okay. It's somehow these kids are fighting for God, and God should bless the troops, and we should have the flag in our church, and we should pledge allegiance and make sure that we're doing that. But you're not pledging allegiance to God, and your kid isn't fighting for God. He is fighting for Wall Street. He is fighting for Washington, D.C.
Well, there was actually some big flap a few years ago that some of the the AR-type platform rifle receivers.
They had a Bible verse on them, right?
Stamped on the side of them, mm-hmm. Yeah. And people said, well, that's just showing it's a religious war. And it's like, you know, I mean, that's the smallest point. It's like,
yeah.
I'm not going to fight to get rid of that and keep the guns pointed at all the brown people.
Yeah, exactly.
And pointed at all the white people in America, you know, pointed at everybody in America. I mean, really, it's like, there's an AR-15 not far from everyone in America that's ready and willing to show up and be pointed at you.
Yeah, it's true. And, you know, I haven't really thought about that, but it damn sure is true. All police departments, they all have a fleet of them. You know, a lot of officers keep them in their car. It's not just their 38 special revolver anymore, like back when we used to call them peace officers.
No, it's a Glock 40 with about four backup high-capacity mags on their belt and an AR-15 in their trunk.
Yeah.
And, you know, a sharpshooter with a 308 that they can get on the phone in about 10 minutes.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, who can kill you from 400 yards away through your curtains.
And not only that, but the SWAT team with their Bearcat, you know, $500,000 armored car with half-inch thick armor on it and turrets that could just obliterate people.
All provided by Homeland.
All paid for by you, the taxpayer.
I heard a great term for Homeland Security the other day. I can't remember or pronounce it, but it's basically one of those compound German words, you know, that are like have like 30 letters in them that are like four words strung together like they do in German.
Uh-huh.
And it was the German words for Department of Homeland Security. And it just looked so Nazi, man. It really did.
Yeah. Like Scott Horton of Anti-War Radio says, when you have a homeland, it's because you have a military empire. You know, it's like having the fatherland. Having a homeland, it means that there's far outposts in the world that you're defending, and those are the outer reaches of the empire, and then you have the homeland that you must keep strong so you can keep your empire.
Yep.
It's all just bull.
So before we get into this accuracy in media report, got a couple other little things right here. Buck Back East made a comment about our We Will Not Disarm video on YouTube I liked.
Oh, good.
He said, rock, rap, and the Second Amendment never went so well together. Each time I listen to this with headphones on, the wife just stares at me as I'm a-grinning. She probably thinks I'm watching porn.
You know, that was a really fun song to make, and I don't know, it was almost like it was preordained that it would sound like it did. I felt like the when you grabbed that bass, the notes just flew out of you, and
like
then,
the gods were writing it through us.
Yes, exactly. We were the muse of liberty.
Like Thomas Jefferson was writing through me, and James Madison was writing through you, and you know, they were saying, I don't want to put this down on paper. Fuck it. I don't want anyone telling us what to do. And they're like, well, we have to put something down in words.
Yeah, although I would go past the Constitution humping there and just say that it was the muse of people everywhere who just yearned to
freedom.
Be free.
It really was. You know, there was a really funny thing on the Colbert Report. I didn't know this. I did know that there was a bill that I don't think passed in Congress that any bill that was presented further after that would have to cite the constitutionality of it, the basis of it, which I think, you know, if you're going to work in that system, you should do that anyway, at least pay lip service to, hey, are we overstepping our bounds that are already overstepping? But New Hampshire had a proposed bill to have to cite for any New Hampshire state bill what part of the Magna Carta made it legitimate. And which, you know, the Magna Carta is the first real freedom document that was kind of a template for some of the American ones, like the Constitution and the maybe the Declaration of Independence. But, you know, it's from like 700 years ago. And Colbert was joking about how Republicans plan for the future by looking far into the distant past. And why not go back to cave paintings? But before he got to that, he was like, and, you know, Romney could cite his wanting to regulate banks by going back to Section 7B of the Magna Carta, where it says, if a wife dies owing money to the Jews, the debt shall be forgiven. And then there's another one like, and Santorum, when talking about human bondage, could cite the part where it says, we must get rid of the Welsh hostage crisis.
Colbert does bring up a good point there. Why should we look? I mean, I know the Magna Carta and the Constitution and all these old documents, they have some good points about liberty in them, but it's all boiled down by the non-aggression principle. That's really all you need. My ears will perk up when legislators start saying, well, how does this fit into the
natural
concept
rights.
Of not only natural rights, but the non-aggression principle? You know, who are we going to have to point guns at in order to get this done? And if it's anybody, if the answer comes back, we're going to have to point the guns at anybody, then we should not pass this law.
Yeah.
In essence, no laws would be passed.
Well, that's our take on it, which is the correct take. Colbert's take was probably, we need to get rid of the Constitution because it limits what guns can be pointed by the government in some way.
Unfortunately, that probably was Colbert's take.
Yeah. Colbert is far more left, far more progressive even than John Stewart, you know. John Stewart wants to hug Judge Napolitano because he's so passionate even though he disagrees with him. Colbert would just make fun of him.
Yeah, yeah. You know, I find myself when I watch Colbert, when he tries to paint, you know, these freedom positions as ridiculous, I agree with him, you know, because he's playing a character and he's like, yeah, we shouldn't have schools. And I'm like, yeah, we shouldn't have schools. Or at
he's
least
pretty much playing
schools.
Like a younger, better looking Bill O'Reilly.
Yeah, yeah. And one who's slightly less of an asshole.
I don't know. I don't know about that.
And now, some corporate whoring for one of our favorite products.
Hi, I'm Neema Vedadi from the Freedom Fiends Podcast, and I'm excited about Vaporsmith's electronic cigarettes. I dig the taste, and I dig the freedom to vape anywhere the nanny staters would wet their pants if I smoked.
Howdy, I'm Michael Dean of the Freedom Fiends, and I love Vaporsmith's. I smoked 3 packs of tobacco cigarettes a day for decades, but now I'm only using Vaporsmith's. I love the flavors, I don't smell like smoke, and I save money, so I have more to spend on ammo and treats for my kiddies.
Vaporsmith's e-cigs revolutionize nicotine ingestion by bringing it into the 21st century. With Vaporsmith's, you'll enjoy all the invigorating nicotine with none of the nasty smoke. The Vaporsmith's are clean, efficient, and tasty. Available in 4 strengths and 10 delicious flavors. Reds, classics, Turkish, menthol, strawberry, cherry, vanilla, coffee, minty mint, and cloves. Go to Vaporsmiths.com. Use coupon code FREEDOMFIEND to get 25% off your order. This is a limited time offer. Vaporsmiths.com is run by a liberty-loving entrepreneur, not some subsidized tax-eater conglomerate. Vaporsmiths at Vaporsmiths.com. Vaporsmiths. I'm enjoying one right now.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
6 drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
Freedom Fiends, anti-war, pro-gun. New show on the Micro Effect Radio Network, Saturdays from 2 to 5 p.m. Pacific Time. Freedom Fiends, Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi's fun and feisty weekly chat about constitutional, libertarian, minarchist, and anarchist issues, abuse of authority by police, the war on drugs, the war on guns, self-defense, states' rights, natural rights, Austrian economics, DIY art, low-budget filmmaking, digital recording, activism, rock and roll, and more. Freedom Fiends. Saturdays from 2 to 5 p.m. Pacific Time. Learn more about The Micro Effect at themicroeffect.com.
So on the break, I stepped out to check the mail, and all that was there was the Casper Star Tribune, which I just threw away. I didn't even look at it, man. You know, we used to call it the Red Star Tribune because it leans socialist,
yes.
communist. But our fan Paul from Florida made up an even better name, which I've added to the glossary, which is the Prairie Pravda.
I love it. That's totally what they are. Statism all around. You know, when I was in journalism school, we had this professor, and he made us buy his book, you know, like professors at big schools often do.
That's why professors write books, because they have a built-in audience of 30 people per semester.
Exactly. And it was called White News, and it was about the fact that wherever you go in America, the faces on the newscast look the same. There's one black person, there's an Asian person.
That could actually be the name of a white supremacist site. Too.
Oh, it might be. But his argument was that because all the journalists come from the same journalism schools and it reflects the demographics of people who want to be in journalism. So it's mostly blonde girls, Asian girls, a black man or two, and a few white guys, and, you know, one Persian person like myself. Actually, there's some other Persian girls I knew that were in news.
Is that the template for putting together a news
pretty
team?
Pretty much,
now?
Pretty much.
They make fun of that on Family Guy where they say, and now Asian correspondent. Trisha Takanawa. Well, you know, they always cut to her by saying Asian news correspondent.
And of course, South Park plays on it by having ridiculous type of demographics like, and now to a midget paraplegic strapped to a donkey.
Yes.
Yes. And, you know, news directors actually do look for the look. They call it just looking for the look. But if they need a girl, they'll throw away all the boys' tapes that send in the tapes that month. If they need a boy, vice versa. If they need a blonde girl, vice versa. And that's how it works. And his argument was, you know, from Hawaii, where everybody's mostly, you know, where there's a lot of natives, to New Mexico, where there's a lot of natives and Hispanics, the newscasts all look the same. I would take that a step further. You know, somebody should write a book, The Status News, because no matter where you go, even if you're in a place like Wyoming, you have the Prairie Pravda. You have the same type of slant on news, the status slant, promoting the status quo. And that's really what mainstream media is they're the keepers of the conventional wisdom. And that's why I had to leave.
Worms.
Worms.
So speaking of inaccuracy in media, there's a site that is hilariously named Accuracy in Media, which bashed our film and all of our friends, pretty much, like a lot of the movers and shakers in the freedom movement, last week. And it's a very popular site. Their Alexa ranking's high, which you'd know if you have the Alexa toolbar, which you should because it's good to have and it helps the freedom fiends for you to have it. By the way, our Alexa ranking is dropping like a rock, which is a good thing.
Oh,
it's going down to the point where it's dropping so fast. You know, it's gone from like 4-point-something million down to 700,000 in 5 weeks, and now it's dropping like between 50 and 100,000 points rank a day.
Yeah.
It's got to slow down at some point, because at this rate, in 2 weeks, we're going to beat Google. We're going to be the number one or number zero site on the web, and we're going to have to hire, I don't know what we'll do, but we'll never get to that
block. We'll hire the fiends. You know, it's like crack. When crack dropped, all the fiends wanted it. That's how freedom is.
And, you know, we would hire the fiends if we got a whole boatload of money.
Oh, yeah.
We'd hire the most, you know, the ones that sent, the ones that are the most proactive and probably don't have a day job. We'd probably hire them at some point.
The ones that fiend the hardest.
This site, Accuracy in Media, I thought at first was like some guy in his, not mother's basement. He's obviously older than me from the way he writes. He's obviously old, but it's not some, you know, a lot of these organizations, like the Brady Gun Campaign is actually like four people working from their homes. Mm-hmm. They even have funding. But I thought this was a guy without funding. I knew that he used to be the editor for Oliver North's newsletter, which is probably how he knows so much about guns, drugs, and violence, which is what he's accusing us Ron Paul lovers of. He basically said Ron Paul fans are anarchists and then showed a clip of our movie, a clip of Pete Eyre slam dancing while open carrying, and which I thought was pretty funny because I wasn't bugged by it, but I think that would just make your average Republican go, oh, they're going too far.
Well, like you mentioned, you say it bashes our movie, but when I read the paragraph, I was like, if I wasn't in that movie, I would go see it, because that doesn't sound awful to me. It sounds awesome.
A lot of the comments were like, I've never heard of this. Thank you. I finally found my tribe. You know?
Right, right.
But this thing got reprinted on a million blogs, like with no comment, which at first really dismayed me, because, you know, some of them were right-wing blogs. But some of them were like patriot blogs, like, you know, Peckerwoods in the Woods with Too Many Guns, as they say in the movie Shooter, which, you know, generally, I have a lot in common with. Mm-hmm. I mean, not everything. They're constitution humpers usually, but they are generally more of my ilk than Newt Gingrich's supporters.
Of course. You live in Wyoming and you have tons of guns. And you have water stored away and a little bit of food stored away and a whole room full of ammo. I won't tell people where that room is.
And I don't trust the federal government. You know, I'm kind of Dale Gribble is my people. I mean, that's an exaggeration. But what I think happened was these people had been like syndicating it in their RSS feed, you know, to show up on their website on some page for years. And this guy has apparently changed. Most of the comments were from freedom people and from people going like, I've never heard of this. Thank you for telling me about it. Mm-hmm. You know, and they said of our movie, like this very dangerous movie, which shows a rapper with a gun in front of a poster of a marijuana plant. And I'm like, doesn't every rap video have a guy with a gun dancing in front of a marijuana plant?
Exactly. It makes it a good rap video.
It read like a soccer mom going, we must do something about this.
Yeah, yeah. It read like the kind of slant they would have made me take if I was going to cover this, you know, when I worked for the CBS affiliate. You could bleep that out if you'd like.
Should I beep that out?
I don't give a shit at this point. It's up to you.
Why don't you say the major media outlet?
The major media outlet affiliate.
You work for two of the three alphabet soup news agencies that predate cable news.
Of course, and when you sent a pitch the other day to a potential interviewee, you said the wrong one, and I said, same shit, different toilet.
Yeah, yeah. So anyway, this guy, let me get his name instead of calling him this guy.
Cliff Kincaid.
Yeah, Cliff Kincaid, who once filed an FCC complaint against Adam Kokesh for his show on Russia TV. Just basically for doing a Russian show on American cable TV.
Or just to be a dick, basically.
Yeah, so this guy, it's not some guy in his basement. It's this guy has an office with nine paid employees in Washington, D.C., in downtown, like the political, you know, where like it's probably $4,000 a month to rent a small office.
Mm-hmm. And you know he doesn't have that much natural income. Accuracy in Media does not get that many views.
Well, I don't know if you know about this part, but he was given $3 million by one of the Mellons, you know, the Mellon and Carnegie Mellon, who that guy is basically Mr. Burns. He's like an 80-year-old neocon Republican. One of the things he's known for is funding the Arkansas Project, which was the legal team that got Clinton impeached over getting a job and lying about
it. Right,
you know, of like, that's what you're going to go after Clinton
over
for?
The wrong things. Of all the evil things Clinton did, you're going to impeach him for getting a job.
You know, I mean, I think the bigger deal was that he immediately like had an undeclared bombing war on a country the next day to bump his job out of the news.
Yeah, what a dick.
Was that Kosovo or was that Yugoslavia? What was it? He blew up an aspirin factory because he said they were making weapons of mass destruction.
Yeah, yeah. And see, back then it was the, you know, he said Slobodan Milosevic had, you know, these mass graves. Nobody ever found the mass graves. Nobody ever found that there was a massacre, you know, and we've progressed so far to where you don't even need to lie like that anymore. When Obama went into Libya, he didn't even say there was already mass graves. He said there could be. You know,
or will be. Or yeah, will be. It's like, I mean, why are Clinton and Obama still heroes to people who hated Bush for being a warmonger?
Because people want their free shit. That's why. I know an Obama supporter who, for the most part, seems to like freedom. You know, he doesn't buy the government line necessarily on 9/11. He hates the Fed. He's ostensibly anti-war. But when Obama got elected, he was just so excited that he might not have to pay high insurance premiums, which is A, false, and B, it's taking a payoff. It's, oh, Obama's going to pay for my shit now? Okay, I'll turn a blind eye to him killing people.
You've seen that video, right, of that black woman at Obama's inauguration going, Obama's going to pay my rent, and Obama's going to pay my student loans, and Obama's going to pay my children, and, like, it did not.
Yeah, and I think the reporter actually went out on a limb, and maybe it wasn't even a reporter, maybe it was just some guy with a camera, and he was like, where is he going to get all this money from? And she's like, I don't know, he just has it.
Yeah.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast. Freedom Fiends is now available for 24/7 streaming to your iPhone, Android phone, or other chromed robot turd. Click on the streaming audio link on freedomfiends.com. That's F-R-E-E-D-O-M-F-E-E-N-S.com.
You know, a little aside, there's one bit of tyranny that's a really tiny bit of tyranny, but it's funny, that we never covered back in July, like right around when we first started. Mm-hmm. Do you know about the fact that Obama signed the Patriot Act over the internet with a robot?
No. He does everything for a robot. He won't go take on a terrorist himself. He sends a robot.
Yeah, but he was in Europe and it legally required his signature. You know, instead of coming rushing back to sign it, he used a pen device over the internet that he signs on one side in Europe, and it replicates mm-hmm. his pen strokes on the document with a real pen on the other end.
I think I vaguely remember that. And there were some people saying, well, it's not constitutional. He has to actually sign it himself, so it's null and void.
Well, he signed it later when he got home, so, you know. But it just brings up interesting, like, almost comical scenarios to me, like T2 kind of scenarios of, like, you know, what happens when the robot decides that the president is not a part of the equation you need, you know?
yeah.
You know, and then just signs into law that robots have voting rights, and then the robots vote in to replace Congress, and then they all lock us out of our smart houses and bomb us because we're a parasite on the earth or something.
Yeah. Stupid robots.
So, Cliff Kincaid.
Yeah, that asshole.
You know, I sent the article to my older sister with the subject line, Republicans calling your little brother a leader of the SDS of the millennium.
Nice.
Students for the Democratic Society. Because, you know, she grew up in the 60s. She was kind of activist. She wasn't like SDS activist. She wasn't radical. But she participated in a protest blockade of this building of the Seabrook nuclear power plant in New Hampshire, which I wouldn't do now, but it's kind of like, she was involved in New Hampshire activism when everybody in Free State Project was a baby or not born.
Of course, I wasn't born then. And from what I've heard, the SDS, you know, their methods were kind of violent. They didn't adhere to the non-aggression principle.
But this article tried to paint us, you know, you, me, our movie, Pete Eyre, Adam Kokesh, Free State Project, as the new SDS, which I actually didn't, I hated the tone of it. It was completely specious. It was basically saying Ron Paul supporters want to kill you. But I wrote a blog post about it saying, like, I don't mind being called in some way the spiritual stepchildren of the yippies, of the radicals of the 60s, not in the same methodology.
But in the radicalism, in the fight against the state, in the status quo, in the establishment. I'll take that any day.
And, you know, their stateless society would probably look like Che Guevara's idea of a stateless society, but go commie go. And the first alternative literature I ever read was Steal This Book by Abby Hoffman, mm-hmm. which I actually, if you want to download it, I linked a PDF of it on my blog post on michaelwdean.com.
Which partly inspired your work on DIY or Die.
Did it?
In a sense. I mean, told people to steal the movie, didn't you?
Oh. The name of it. Yeah, I said DIY or Die, burn this DVD. That is named after that book. You know, actually, the copy I had of that book was given to me. I didn't steal it, but it was stolen by my friend from his brother, who stole it from someone else, and then someone stole it from me. It was basically a pre-internet planned meme. Like, this book's going to get around because people will steal it. And it kind of made fun of property rights, which I didn't like, or I think it's funny, but I don't agree with it, of like, nobody owns anything, so you can steal this book. And actually, a lot of bookstores wouldn't carry that book because people kept stealing it. He was turned down by like 30 publishers before Abby Hoffman found a publisher, and one of them said, this book will end free speech as we know it. Which is quite a quote. But, you know, it has a lot about guns and weed, but it's basically smoke weed and then go, here's how to shoot cops, which we don't agree with. But it did have a section on what are the best guns to carry for self-defense or for whatever.
Okay.
A lot of it's not useful anymore because a lot of it was about, like, trying to scam the phone companies with things that won't even work anymore. And there's a lot of, like, phone numbers of places you can get free food in different cities that don't exist anymore. But there's a lot of stuff that's good in it, like how to prepare, what kind of gas mask to use if you're going to an event where you think they're going to use tear gas.
Ah, that's useful. Especially useful today.
Yeah, but this guy, Cliff Kincaid, has $3 million in funding from basically Mr. Burns, you know, basically from this 80-year-old billionaire who is a Republican who wants to entrench the Fed and the people who will give favors to his corporations.
He wants to maintain the status quo because he's rich right now. The richest people will always push the government to maintain the status quo because in the status quo, they're doing well. They're successful. They're on top. The status quo means they remain on top. And I have no problem with rich people at all. But I do have a problem with people using the guns of the state to either get that richness or maintain it. And that's what this guy seems to be trying to do here.
And it's interesting, too, because he's so old, he will die soon. And that's, like, one of my positive points about this whole thing is all of these people are old and will die, and their ideas will die with them. And what I said in my commentary on it was, your generation is going to die out. Your ideas are going to die with you. There's no way that in 20 years in America, gay marriage is going to be illegal. There's no fucking way.
I don't think there's a way the drug war will be around in 20 years.
Right, right. There's no fucking way. Like, no matter how many bricks they put in the wall before they die, they're going to get knocked out.
Exactly.
It may not be libpair in 20 years, but you're going to be able to smoke a joint and have gay sex and be married.
It reminds me of that Jay-Z line, I want to end your career, but you're going to do it for me.
Yeah. On the last cast, you said, fortunately, the baby boomers will die out. But, you know, my wife is a baby boomer. I just missed it by a couple years, but fortunately, they won't all die. She's on the young end of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Mr. Burns is older than the baby boomers.
Your wife is very healthy and obviously not a statist, so she'll live on.
Right. Yeah, libertarians live long. So I'm even wondering why, like, Mr. Burns even cares anymore. I mean, the Mellons are so entrenched. On the East Coast, every third building has that family name on it because they own it and donated it. I guess you think he'd be like caring for his children and grandchildren, but like they have more money than God. I mean, they're like Rothschild rich and control the universe. And it's like, at that point of being that old and still being entrenched in this kind of shit, I think it's just ideological. It's like, I must give money to people who will fight liberty, you know?
They're robots too, I guess.
My comment to him, my comment in my blog post that I think is really the punchline of this whole thing and the important takeaway is, I said, you guys will eventually die off and America will go one of two ways. It'll go to socialism or it'll go to freedom. And you think we're part of the problem, but we're the people that's going to help it stay going towards freedom and away from socialism. Everybody named in that article are the people who are influencing the people who are going to keep the march from socialism from happening.
Yeah, yeah.
And we hate communism as much as those old people hate communism. Although we wouldn't hate the idea of a voluntary commune that's self-contained and doesn't seep into us and try to destroy us and take our money.
Well,
they'd hate that, but
part of the thing about it is, and I said as much when I was interviewing Robin Kerner, us people my age and people who are in the liberty movement, you know, we don't see any benefit to maintaining the status quo. We don't see any benefit from the way things work now. We don't want to conserve, you know, the status quo. We don't want to conserve an American system where you have a Federal Reserve and where you have eternal war. We don't want that at all because it doesn't benefit us at all.
I would think that someone like Mr. Burns would want to keep the Federal Reserve going because he wouldn't, he'd be painting houses without it.
Exactly. And that's where the real battle is. And like you said, we don't have to fight that hard because those people are going to die off.
Yep. Robin actually just wrote me back and answered some questions and wants to do another interview in a month.
Excellent.
So there were a couple more comments on this horrible, and the name of this thing we never mentioned. It's called, what is it? Ron Paul Guns, Weed, and the Revolution or something like that. I don't even know, man.
That sounds awesome. No, it's Drugs, Guns, and Madness in the Ron Paul Revolution is the title of the piece.
And, you know, there were a couple comments on the thread from longtime readers and followers of him who were like, what the f*** is happening to you? You know, one of them was like, I've been following you for decades. I loved your work on the UN. I used to hand it out at my lefty college. But now you just sound like an old drunk yelling at people in a bar.
Yep. That about sums it up.
Yeah. And another guy said, old school conservatives like us used to understand that big government in our own country was the biggest threat to our liberty, not gay Muslim Mexicans. Peace, liberty, and sound money are the future of the conservative movement, Cliff. Get with the program or get left behind. And that's from a longtime reader of his, too.
I love that sentiment. Get with the program or get left behind.
Or get left behind.
Reminds me of Heinlein on the moon. You either adapted or you died.
Yeah.
And that's really the truth.
Cliff Kincaid and his Mr. Burns melon sponsor are basically the T2 splashing in the molten palladium.
The molten palladium, I like that.
Yeah, it's not molten steel, it's molten palladium, because yes. They're so rich. I've been really into the idea of metals lately. Like, not, I haven't bought any for investing. I invest in lead, but...
That's a metal, Michael. Counts.
But I've been fascinated by the idea of metals. And my wife was cleaning out her jewelry box the other day. And she came across this thing her dad gave her like 20 years ago. He was a contractor in Saudi Arabia. Let's not talk about that. But he had this little, it's 15 grams of silver. Hmm. It's like a little silver bar, a half ounce silver bar that has a little loop in it to like wear it around your neck. And it has Saudi writing on it. And on the back of it, it's got a palm tree with two crossed swords underneath it. Mm-hmm. It looks really, really Muslim. I told her I wanted her to give it to me, and I wanted to attach it under the end of the barrel on my AK-47.
Nice.
She didn't like the idea.
I have that, you know, in Iran. Whenever my dad used to go to Iran, he would bring me back some gold, because that's what the family would give him to give to me. So I have a little gold bar that's on a chain, and basically that's all it is a gold bar. It says my name on it to wear around your neck is, you know, your own little personal savings account.
Does it have a palm tree with cross swords?
No. That's a Saudi symbol.
With a crescent moon? No.
The Iranians don't have the palm tree as one of their symbols. Yep. We have a lion, or I guess the crescent moon if you're Muslim, or an image of Iran. But yep. Yeah, Iranians and Saudis are completely different.
So that article about us and our friends got blogged about on Lou Rockwell, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
The only regret I have about the whole article, and this is selfish and silly, but it's funny, is I wish that instead of embedding our YouTube video, they'd link the Guns and Weed site, which has it embedded, because they would have worked to improve our SEO.
There you go.
We did sell some movies of it, so thank you, Inaccuracy in Media, for selling, making us some money.
You know, I have a friend on Facebook, Charles, and he commented, like, dangerous rapper. You know, they must have not found out that you were half Iranian, half Sicilian. The article could have taken a different turn.
I know. And do you know any rapper who would be offended by being called dangerous in the media?
Hell no.
That's, most of them wish they were and can't get called dangerous.
Right.
Most of the up-and-coming ones, such as yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
Do the Freedom Fiends make you purr? Tell them so at talkback@freedomfiends.com.
So, Neema Vedadi, how are you?
I'm chilling, Michael. What's up?
I'm good. I want to... There's an article here on Reddit that says, not The Onion, which is funny because, you know, I thought that thing about us was from The Onion when I first read it.
The Accuracy in Media thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this says, not The Onion, court okays barring high IQs for cops. This is from ABC News.
I thought they already did that. Cops. Police departments. I thought they already picked the dumber ones.
A man whose bid to become a police officer was rejected after he scored too high on an intelligence test has lost an appeal in his federal lawsuit against the city. The Second Circuit Court of Appeals in New York upheld a lower court's decision that the city did not discriminate against Robert Jordan because the same standards were applied to everyone who took the test. Mm. This kind of puts an official face, and he talks about discrimination and how, you know, it's not fair. But the bigger story here to me is, like, really? They're admitting in court, in law, they don't want cops to be too smart.
How high did he score on this intelligence?
Not that high, like 128.
Oh, that's where I'm at. So I can't be a cop?
Right. And you can be a detective, probably. Basically, they want beat cops to have an IQ of about 103, which is 100 is average.
Yeah.
They want the cop to be just slightly smarter than the average person, but not too smart that they're going to think on themselves or have problems taking orders.
Taking orders, right.
So, you know, and I'm pretty sure that you have to be smarter than that to be a detective, because detectives rise up through the ranks of the cops. You know, the mm-hmm. cream, the smarter right. The ones that can do basic math and solve a puzzle become detectives.
It's more political than that too, Michael, though. I mean, the ones who play by the rules and get in the good graces of the chief are also the ones yeah. who become detectives.
But guy with an IQ of 103 probably wouldn't make detective. But if they're going to bar smart guys from being beat cops, though, how are they going to rise through the ranks and have smart detectives, which they need? My IQ is 147, which means I should never have to talk to a cop. If a cop approaches me, I should just say, I am infinitely more intelligent. I am logarithmically more intelligent than you. Go away.
Mundane. Yeah, it should be the other way around.
You think that'll work? No. If I say, I have an IQ of 147, you're not smart enough to contact me.
Not at all. Because the only thing that matters to them is that they're wearing a badge and they got a gun.
I rather think that would work against me.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You'd be an uppity slave. You must be thrown in the cage.
I know.
Get anally raped for a little bit, and then we'll see how smart you are, Michael.
Yeah, and that one's been covered by a whole bunch of news sources, you know, alternative and mainstream weeks ago, but I just couldn't not mention it. I forgot about that. And
I think it deserves mentioning. There was also a story, I think Will Grigg might have brought this to my attention, at least that's where I think I read it, a couple years ago. There was an officer in, I think it was the Austin Police Department, and he answered in some personality test or something like that. He was a very religious guy, and he basically led them to believe that he would go with his moral convictions over the orders of a superior officer if they conflicted. And they threw him out of the force, basically saying, you know, your job is to take orders. It's not to be a moral person. It's not to do the right thing. It's to do whatever the fuck we tell you to do.
Do you know what Feen means in German?
Fairy.
Fairy. We're the fairy. Freedom fairies.
We are. We bring freedom to you. We tap you on the nose. We boop you with our little wands, and then you feel free.
We take your body parts from under your pillow and leave you money of freedom.
We email you bitcoins after we take your body parts.
Here you go. There's a Wagner opera called Die Fiends, which, you know, reads as Die Fiends.
Die Fiends, die.
So that woman in Oklahoma that was cleared of the criminal charges in that righteous self-defense shooting, you know, the one, the 18-year-old widow who
the media had posed with a phone in her ear and a shotgun in her hand. Yeah. So, well, that's good, though. You know, she was cleared of wrongdoing, huh? So they're not going to prosecute her for anything?
Right.
Good.
You know, and usually when you shoot someone in self-defense, I mean, oftentimes they arrest you and you may spend some time in jail until you're cleared. But usually, you know, you can get bail or get out or you're released OR. But, you know, I was thinking about how that would play differently if she'd lived in Boston or Newark or Los Angeles or New York City. Here's how I think it would have gone. The woman would have been cuffed, arrested, and put in jail. The detectives would tear her house apart, read all her emails, confiscate her computer for a few months. They'd go through her personal effects, touch her panties. The detectives would make jokes like, yeah, she's psycho, but I'd do her. Her baby would have been taken by CPS, and animal control would take her pets. A relative would offer to take care of the kid and the pets, but would not be permitted to for their own safety. She'd have to mortgage her house and lose any inheritance and life insurance from her husband to pay the bill and hire a lawyer. She'd get out of jail on bail. She'd live in terror of prison for 3 to 6 months before she's cleared of the criminal charges. In 6 months, the DA would clear her of criminal charges reluctantly. If it were an election year, he'd prosecute her, but it isn't, so he doesn't. People would drive up and down her street yelling, "Murderer!" at her. They'd vandalize her house and yard. She'd finally get her kid back. Her pets would have been put down by the pound in some odd loophole where they have to kill unclaimed pets in 90 days, and she wasn't permitted to claim her pets because they were evidence in a homicide investigation. The mother of the scumbag she rightfully dispatched to the next world would go on TV and give newspaper interviews calling her a monster. The tearful mother would be saying, why'd she have to kill my baby? He had some problems, but he was a good boy. Why didn't she shoot him in the hand and just wound him? If the dead scumbag was white, the Brady campaign would contact the scumbag's mother and provide free lawyers for a civil suit against the woman who shot in self-defense. If the dead scumbag was black, Al Sharpton and or Jesse Jackson would contact the scumbag's mother and provide free lawyers for a civil suit against the woman who shot in self-defense. The woman who shot in self-defense would lose the civil suit and spend the rest of her life working at Walmart to pay it off. And Mama Liberty replied to that, except in Chicago, where she'd have been killed by the responding officer simply because she mentioned the word gun to the dispatcher.
Wow. Yeah, Mama Liberty took it on a whole new level of cynicism. I was going to take it one step further, but Mama Liberty sort of eclipsed me there. I was going to say they would find a little marijuana pipe or plant it there and say it was drug related and then confiscate all her stuff and throw her in prison for actually some number of years, or say it's gang related and put on one of these gang aggravator things that they have in here in Washington State. If you do any crime that's related to gangs, you can get, you know, years and years added onto your sentence. In fact, there was a kid who was he was just driving, an 18-year-old kid driving during a drive-by. I don't even think anybody was hurt in it, but the kid got almost life in prison for that just because it was related to a gang. And all they have to do nowadays is do those things. They say it's either drug-related or gang-related, and your life is f***ed. When I was in the news, we did this one story. It was my job to do it. This guy, he was growing marijuana. Here in Washington State, you're allowed to grow marijuana, but he had one too many plants, or 20 too many plants, or whatever it is, because it's completely fucking arbitrary. They stole all his guns. I had to go in there and take video of, he had a nice collection too. He had some Dragunovs and some nice old guns and really cool stuff. They just stole all his guns. You know, the guns had nothing to do with the fucking weed. They just stole the guns, put him in jail.
There was a case in either Illinois or Michigan last year where there was a guy who legally owned a bunch of guns, you know, like this guy, like legally owned a bunch of guns, had not committed anything that's a crime on the books, like pot, which shouldn't be a crime, but is. And there was some reason the so-called authorities had to come in his house. He was out of town and his house was robbed and a neighbor called the police. Mm-hmm. The cops went in the house and they found his gun collection, which was like 60 or 70 guns, all legally owned, but the cops took them because they said he had too many guns, which isn't a law. It was a decision of the cops.
Wow. Yeah, and that is f***ed up, and the media won't question it. You know, I've seen it personally. Reporters write, as part of their report or copy, the fact that somebody in a crime or a suspect, and somebody who's not even convicted, they'll say something like, plus a house full of guns. And, you know, you imagine the dun-dun-dun. Although they...
Yeah, in California, they call them assault rifles, even if they're, you know, 38 special revolvers.
Right, right. And to me, how far gone are news reporters and the general public that seems frightening to them? You know, guns are protected by the Bill of Rights just like freedom of the press. To me, saying somebody had a lot of guns and expecting an imagined dun-dun-dun after that is like saying he had a table full of newspapers or he had a Bible on his desk.
Or the New York Times has too many words.
Right. Yeah, people are supposed to have fucking guns. It's protected.
Ugh. Speaking of words, Lake Superior State University, a Michigan school, published a list, the 2012 list. This is something they do every year. The 2012 list of words they think should be banished from the English language. And I'm like, right. Banished? Like, with guns? Like, you're hauled off to a camp or fined if you use them? Banished.
I read it, though. It was sort of lighthearted. I think they were just around because it was just words they didn't want to hear anymore, basically.
Yeah, but even so, the way they use it, I mean, this is something that Bill O'Reilly would probably agree with.
Probably. Giant 1984 parallel there. For those of you who've read 1984, they had a dictionary called Newspeak, and everybody was supposed to speak Newspeak. And what they did every year was they tried to reduce the number of words in the language so that there would be less ability for abstract or complex thought. They wanted people to speak in what was called duck speak, which is basically just quacking what you're supposed to quack. And so, yeah, that kind of harkens to that.
I like how much the phrase newspeak sounds like news speak.
You think that was intentional on George Orwell's part?
I think it might have been. I don't even know if newspeak was a term back then, but, you know, the news is certainly an enforcer of newspeak and the state.
News is an enforcer of horizontal enforcement, which, like we've said before, and like other people have put out there, like there's this great video, I think you posted it on a Fiends post a while ago, about obedience. Like that's really what keeps us in line, is people who are obedient to the tyrants. If we said, hey, we're not going to follow your orders, borders, we wouldn't have to worry about it. And what news does is it protects, like we said, the conventional wisdom. It takes this horizontal enforcement and drives it home and makes us feel like the quote-unquote independent press believes this way and it must be right because they're saying it and everybody at the water cooler is saying you can't have guns, you shouldn't have guns, the government should protect these people, they should steal our money and pay for poor people. And that just becomes... it just becomes the way the world works.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
You know, speaking of dystopias, I saw Logan's Run last night.
You were telling me you didn't really dig it this time, huh?
Yeah, it's a 70s movie. It actually stars Michael York, who was in The Taming of the Shrew, you know, classical British actor, and Farrah Fawcett is in it. I saw it when it came out in the theaters in 78 when I was 14 and loved it because it was, oh, the future, it's weird, it's strange, it's dark, but it's not a very good movie. It's no Brave New World. It's not either of the Brave New Worlds. It's not the 1984 movie.
It's not Moon.
It's not Moon.
Spoiler alert.
It basically takes place in the future, and it's another one of those things of where babies are made in factories, you know, no one is the parent of the kids, and you're terminated by the state at a certain age. Mm-hmm. But instead of being terminated at, you know, 60 or 70 with almost a tiny bit of dignity like you are in Brave New World, with comfort at least, in Brave New World or in Soylent Green. You know, in Soylent Green, you go into this place when you decide to die and they let you listen to classical music and show you beautiful scenes of the flora and fauna that used to exist on this earth. But in this one, they do this thing called carousel where they launch you up into the air with people cheering and shoot you with lasers till you blow up. At age 30, and in the book it was 21. And, you know, of course, people try to run and get away from it to not have to do that and go to the outside world, outside the domes, mm-hmm. and in the savage world, which again is f***ing filmed in the Conejo Valley in California, where I lived.
Yeah.
You know, in Malibu State Park, which is where MASH was filmed.
You were destined to be on the Freedom Reservation, Michael.
I know, man. But there is one really cool thing in this. It's one scene that's really long in the brutal world. The brutal world is not filled with thousands of primitive people. There's one guy in it, and it's the first old people these people have seen. You know, the people from the domed world.
Right.
They've never seen an old person before, and they're like touching his face and his white hair and his beard and like, oh, what's wrong with your face? And he's the only good actor in it, and he's the only good part in it. He's played by Peter Ustinov, who was in Fiddler on the Roof. He's the guy who sings If I Were a Rich Man in Fiddler on the Roof.
Which you said used to be called If I Were a Rothschild.
Yeah, yeah. Who's, you know, he's an award, Academy Award winning, just brilliant British stage actor who made it in movies. And he is living in Washington, D.C. in what was formerly Congress. The building of Congress is overrun with ivy and it's falling apart. And he's in the congressional chamber living with all this decay and things falling off the walls and about 200 feral cats. And he's this really sweet guy, and he's, you know, living in Congress with a bunch of cats. Mm-hmm. I like that. And the people from the domed world say, can we stay here? And he's like, of course, it belongs to the people. And they look around and say, what people? And he says, oh, I don't know, their names are carved up there on the wall somewhere. It's brilliant.
Nice, nice.
Yeah.
Speaking of movies, we did give a homework assignment last cast to go out and watch Moon. Do you want to discuss that a little bit, Michael?
Yeah, well, I guess we can have spoilers now and talk about the plot of it.
Well, spoiler alert.
So basically, it's a guy living on the moon who's in charge of the mining operation on the moon. He's the only guy there. And he finds out that the corporation that put him there for 3 years has no plans of sending him back. And he's actually a clone of the same guy. They have like 40 copies of the guy.
More than that. They have like a whole warehouse full. It must have been 100 or thousands.
Yeah. What happens is he apparently dies while out in this moon rover checking on some process. And the central computer, which is voiced by Kevin Spacey, mm-hmm. which is f***ing brilliant.
Yes.
Who, it's basically Hal from 2001, but it doesn't want to kill him.
It wants to help him. Helping you, Sam, is what I do.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, so the computer thaws out another clone, but then that clone has some memory of, like, something happened out there, and he goes out and rescues the guy who's not actually dead and brings him back. So for the first time in this operation, there are two of the clones awake at the same time. And hilarity ensues in a way. They get into a couple fights, and they're so evenly matched, you know, physically and mentally, that they can't do anything to each other.
Except for this, Michael. The clone who's been there for 3 years is starting to age. The movie sort of leads you to believe that this happens to all of them. Their hair starts falling out, their teeth starts falling out.
It's not really aging. I think it's like radiation poisoning. Like, they're, you know,
maybe
something up there is making, I mean, the guy's like 35 years old and he's looking like he's dying of cancer. Yeah.
Whatever it is, the clones aren't able to last longer than 3 years,
which is why they have clones. And they've implanted them with memories of a wife and baby daughter back on Earth
that they think they're going home to. They think at the end of their 3 years, they're going home to their family on Earth. And this is what struck me. In the last cast, I said that there's a moment in here that will strike you just as that moment in 1984 when they realized that the telescreen was watching them and that Winston was going to be captured and taken to be tortured. There's a moment when Gertie, the computer, puts in the password and Sam is actually able to see what happened to all the other clones, all the other Sams. And what he sees is that they age and then they get into this pod that's supposedly is going to freeze them for their 3-day trip back to Earth. What it does instead is it vaporizes them instantly. It's like a microwave. Yeah. It's like that. And he goes and checks it out, and there's a video of somebody basically saying, "We're so proud of you. Just remember as you go to sleep how proud your family and the whole Earth will be for your service here on the moon." And then flash, they're vaporized instantly. And that chilled me so much to the bone. And I watched it with my wife again for a second time. She didn't watch it the first time. And it didn't really strike her. You know, she was saying, well, they were going to die in 3 years anyway, and I might as well think when I die happy thoughts that I'm going to be sent to my family. And there it hit me. I wouldn't want that. When I die, I don't want to be lied to. And I thought of all those soldiers in Iraq and in Afghanistan who think that they're fighting for freedom and then step on an IED and are just instantly blown to bits. And I thought, what I want more than anything in this world is truth. And I want to die knowing how I'm going to die and why I'm going to die and why the world is the way it is. I don't want to die in ignorant bliss.
I think a lot about death. I have thought about my own mortality longer and harder and from a younger age than people are supposed to. And it's not a fatalistic thing or a dark thing. I've really tried to wrap my head around it a lot since my first relative died when I was 7, my grandfather, who I really cared about a lot. And I actually thought I was going to be dead by age 30. Like, it was a stated goal of mine when I was playing in rock bands at 22. Mm-hmm. You know, live fast, die young, leave a green corpse with a needle hanging out of it, and be a star forever. You know, I wanted to be Kurt Cobain before I knew who Kurt Cobain was. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm sure I didn't picture shooting myself, but it was probably a drug overdose or AIDS I thought I'd die of from screwing too many girls. What's his name from NWA? You know, that's what I wanted to be.
Eazy-E.
Yeah. But, you know, then I hit 30 and I was just 2 weeks off drugs and have been off since and was like, okay, I'm not dead now and I'm not a rock star. What do I do? And I had to kind of reinvent myself and find other things to do, like media production and reaching the world in other ways.
Yeah.
Writing books, making movies, podcasting, etc. And just living a life that I liked and sharing it, finding someone to share it with who I loved,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Which really I think is the goal. You know, they say, like, when it gets down to everything, you know, when people get older, they generally have this realization of, like, it's all about family. And for me, that's not having a kid, because I had a kid and she died. And before she got sick, I had a vasectomy and decided I'd never want to have a kid again. And even now that she's dead, I don't want to reverse my vasectomy. And my wife's 52. She can't have kids. I don't want kids. We don't want kids.
And your daughter would have been 28. What was it yesterday?
28 yesterday. Yeah. I mean, she would have been like 4 months older than you, pretty much.
Less than that. I'm going to be 28 on March 9th. So a couple months older than me. It's weird.
Yeah, that's weird. You know, and I feel some significance to that. Not like you're my kid or anything. I mean, I think of you as a peer, maybe more of a little brother than a son. But, you know, another thing, the lady who made that movie, Libertopia, mm-hmm. about the Free State Project,
yeah.
She was born the same week and year as my daughter, which is something I noticed from her Facebook birthday, you know.
Okay.
Interesting. And I don't think of her as my daughter, but, you know, I just noticed that and chatted with her about it in other things we were chatting about, movies and liberty.
Well, so how do you want to die, Michael? Because when I saw the movie, like I said, that moment when they incinerate him and he thinks he's going back home to his family, it disturbed me so much because he was so unaware of what was happening. But then later on in the movie, you know, the other clone of Sam Bell devises this plan to get back to Earth. And part of that includes taking the sick, the 3-year-old Sam Bell, the one who's going to die from aging anyway. Part of that includes taking him back to the destroyed rover and putting him back in it so that the cleanup crew thinks he's still there and doesn't think that there's a problem. And when they drive out to where that is and they sit in front of the moon for a little bit, he knows he's going to die. And so what he does is he just starts to talk about the memory. And Sam knows that the memory's a lie. He knows that he doesn't have a wife on Earth waiting for him. He knows that he doesn't have a daughter on Earth waiting for him. But it's just the other Sam peacefully explaining one of the memories that they share. And that kind of peaceful death, where he knows the truth, but he's willing to indulge in the fantasy for a little bit longer as he dies. And then the moment before he dies, he sees the other Sam going back to Earth. And he knows that there will be a future for that Sam. That's how I want to die. I want to die with a happy ending in the sense that I know something is going to be made right. A wrong is going to be righted.
So it's interesting that we're getting off on this kind of tangent about mortality. I do want to tie it back to the movie, but it's a pretty important subject for me. I mean, like, when I was 14 or 12, I was, like, writing poems about death.
Yeah.
But they always had some kind of renewal in it, like not reincarnation or heaven, but more like metaphorically of, like, autumn and winter as death and spring as rejuvenation. And then a lot of the lyrics that I wrote in the band Bomb were about death and heaven, even though I didn't really believe in heaven.
And you have a song in Right Arm of Wyoming, too, on that album, where it's basically how you imagine your death going down.
Yeah, it's called, we've played it before on the cast, it's called Single Crackling Blue Flash, and it's basically, the whole song takes place in about 10 seconds. The idea is, like, the Fed goons kick in the door, I run to the back of the house, I grab a gun, I probably don't even get off a shot. They shoot me, and even there's thoughts as the bullet is entering my brain of it looks like a blue flash entering my brain, and then I'm gone. The lyrics are basically like, you know, all my things and all my cats and all my words and everything I've ever done in life gone in an instant, but there's something about my essence being too much to just end when there's a bullet, which I've always believed. It's like, I don't believe in heaven, I don't believe in reincarnation, but it's like, there's something more to me, I guess to all people, but I can only speak for myself. I know in my soul, in my heart of hearts, that there's something more to me than just a bunch of chemicals and electrical impulses and something that will carry on after the heart stops beating forever. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's my words and my art. I don't know. I used to, the first novel I wrote, which was the first really long form piece of art I ever did entirely on my own. You know, before that I'd played in bands, but I wrote a novel called Starving in the Company of Beautiful Women. I started it when I was still using heroin, and then I really wrote it and made it work once I got clean, the first year I got clean. And when I was even using heroin, I had it as like a bunch of dictation into a dictaphone, and I had a bunch of tapes, and I told my girlfriend at the time, who was a secretary and good with words and good with editing and stuff, you know, if I die, you have to promise me you'll edit this into a book and get it published, and which is a ridiculous request. Mm-hmm. Both parts of that are a ridiculous request.
Yeah.
It was a bunch of ramblings on stone ramblings on tape, but she reluctantly promised she would, and then, you know, we broke up and I got sober. Then I got a computer and I started working on it. And when I first started working with a computer, one thing that really struck me was the ability to edit.
Yeah.
I could move stuff around and I could delete stuff. And I was like, I actually got the computer while I was still using, and it was too old and crappy to sell. It was like, this is like 1993, and it was, you know, running DOS after Windows came out. And so I wasn't able to hawk it for drugs. So I kept it and started writing this novel on it. When I realized you could cut and paste stuff, even without a mouse, like highlighting with the scroll bar and stuff in Word Perfect, moving it around in DOS, I was like, why can't I do that with my life? Why can't I highlight drug addiction and edit it out? Why can't I highlight depression and edit it out? And a lot of what I've done since then has been an attempt to do that. Like with the book User's Manual, The Human Experience, it basically explains how to do that. It's a little more complicated than highlighting and hitting delete, but I've done that and I've become a pretty happy person. But I've still thought a lot about mortality. There was something in that book, Starving in the Company of Beautiful Women. I can't find it. I don't have the PDF of it or the book in front of me. But there was a line that was tongue-in-cheek about, like, what will I do when I grow up? I was like 30. I was at the emotional age that most 18-year-olds are at, probably, because I'd been using drugs since then and hadn't grown. Using hard drugs every day and alcohol every day and hadn't grown. So I was kind of stilted in a lot of ways, and yeah. I had to do a lot of catching up to do. So,
yeah.
You know, I was like, what am I going to do when I grow up? And I was like, one of the scenarios I had was I'll live out in the desert and have a cult and have a choir. I'll have a choir of 50 blonde women, 50 blonde virgins singing my praises as I die in a hail of ATF bullets. Now, I didn't own guns then, and I didn't hate the government then, and I don't know where that came from. Probably watching Waco on TV, but yeah. You know, it's pretty funny. And then I say to myself in the book, or my character that's based on me, Cash Newman, basically says, fuck it. I'll probably just get married to one woman, be happy, and learn to weld and make big, crappy, creaky art out of old cars, which is kind of funny because, like, I didn't realize then, and probably nobody did, that, you know, if that was your hobby, by now, in most places, the county would be trying to tax you and take away your creaky right. old cars.
Right.
You know, I thought a lot about mortality, and I don't necessarily have to die peacefully. I envision that I probably will. I will probably die in this house with my wife holding my hand, or, you know, she'll die with me holding her hand and I'll die of heartbreak 2 weeks later. I don't know. But I imagine I'm going to die peacefully of old age in this house, which I never thought would be something that I could reasonably say. I think at this point I can.
I just want to die knowing that I at least fought for truth. I don't want to die and look back on my life and think that things were a lie or that I was doing something wrong. And that's why the movie struck me so much. Because when I die, you know, like you said in your Crackling Blue Flash song, you know, I wouldn't mind that. I mean, I don't want to die, obviously, with the SWAT team raiding me. But I think of rap lines, and I think it might have been Jay-Z who said, I'd rather die fighting than on my knees. And that's a sentiment that's been put out there before. That's how I feel. I don't want to die comfortable if the trade-off is truth or what's right.
Me neither. And, you know, to take it back further, I mean, I grew up listening to Jimi Hendrix, and he said, I'm the one that's got to die when it's time for me to die, so let me live my life the way I want to. And I heard that as a kid, and I was like, that's my life. And, you know, looking back, I don't want that to just be some hippie thing I said as a kid and believed. It's my life.
Amen.
There's an interesting discrepancy here where it shows our age differences, and it's not like, boy, son, you're where I used to be and someday you'll grow up. It's more like I actually feel at this point in my life that I've done enough that I could get f***ing droned right now and die happy. I mean, I don't think I'd actually be happy if I looked up and saw a drone coming at my window. And they do that. They target to come through a window or a door. And you'd probably see them and hear them a few seconds before they killed you.
Do you think, because that's one of the other things that struck me about the movie. I thought dying like that, getting in that pod and being incinerated in a flash, to me it reminded me of what would happen. That must be what it's like for the people getting droned. Because you don't really know. You might have 1 second of forethought thinking, oh, shit. But then it's instantaneous. Your death is like that. And when I was a kid, I had the same fear after I saw Terminator 2, and there's that scene where the nuclear blast demolishes everything. You have that second of knowledge, and then all of a sudden, you're gone.
Well, you know, I think with drones, I'm staring out my window right now looking at the sky, and if I saw something out of the corner of my eye, I'd look up. I think I'd have 10 or 20 seconds of knowledge of, hey, I think that's a drone. You know, I mean, I almost wonder in a way, since drones are allegedly they're revenge for 9/11. They kind of work like 9/11 because some of those people in those buildings saw that fucking thing coming. And the ones that were incinerated instantly, didn't see that plane coming, you know, lived for minutes and some of them jumped out the window. Yeah. But, you know, really drones have been planned for a long time. I mean, really the thing I've heard is that's what Area 51 is where they developed the drones, you know. And for a long time, people said, oh, there were UFOs there. No, it's like That was either a rumor started by the government or a rumor allowed by the government in the 40s to explain the fact that people who lived in that area would look up and see things that were behaving in ways that known aircraft couldn't behave.
Maybe.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFiends.com.
But getting off the... Did you have something to say?
Just that I'm scared shitless of drones. Actually, I'm not scared. Fuck it.
I'm not. I'm not going to die from drones.
I think dying from drones is a ridiculous thing, and I'm very saddened that that is a common occurrence in the world today.
No, I'm more afraid of, and not even afraid of, just I think a way I could die is, I mean, if some cop pulled me over and tried to hassle me for some bullshit, I'd probably be respectful up to a point, but there's probably a point where I'm going to be like, fuck you, and not pull a gun on him, and just be fucking screaming at him because he's a tyrant and he's a tool of the state and he's violating the Constitution and my natural rights and just being a pig, and he's just going to fucking off me and then put a gun in my hand. I mean, that's a way I could see dying.
Yeah, I worry about that too. I have a natural inclination. I get this weird mode. I almost feel like I'm Wolverine in that one Wolverine video game back in the day where you get into berserker mode. I have this anti-authority thing in me that I can just go crazy and just say, fuck you to authority.
We've talked about how, and I've read some of my, like, 8th grade report cards said that. You know, Michael has a problem with authority. Neema doesn't want to do what he's told.
Well, there's a few instances. I think I might have mentioned it on a cast before when some bullshit bus monitor tried to tell me I couldn't walk on the sidewalk because I didn't have a bus pass. And she tried to take me to the principal, and I said, how fast can you run? And I just ran away from her fat ass. And I worry that one day I'll be pulled over, and for some reason that switch will just flip in me, and I'll just be like, you know what? F*** you. And I'll just drive off.
Yeah, and then they'll chase you, and they'll catch you, and you'll get out of your car, and they'll shoot you.
They'll riddle me with bullets.
Yeah, they'll riddle you with bullets. You won't even pull a gun. They'll just riddle you with bullets. Because you're not complying quick enough or something, and they'll say you're committing aggression. Yeah. They actually use that terminology. I mean, even in Arrested Development, the cops, when they shoot the puppet, they're like, put up your hands, or we'll take it as a sign of aggression. And it's a puppet with no human there, so it doesn't put up its hands, and they shoot it. But, you know, cops use that terminology. A sign that you're committing aggression. You're aggressing on us. No, we're not. We're just, back to mortality. This is a really pleasant conversation.
How are we going to bring this back to a happy ending that we need in a few minutes?
I can. My whole life, I've always been about the art. You know, I've always been about, I mean, basically everything I've ever done, I've done as if it's the last thing I'll ever make. And I tell people, I tell artists, you know, what advice do you have for artists? I say, do everything you do as if it's the only thing that'll ever be seen by you.
Yeah.
And in this day and age, it can be, because things can go viral.
Not only that, but every time we work on something, you're always backing it up and sending me a hard drive and saying, if I die, make sure this gets out there.
Yeah, and interestingly, I've been like that with every phase of everything I've done, and I've generally taken one subject to the maximum. Like, I will discover something, become an expert on it, you know, write the expert book on it, and then get bored with it and move on to something else. And I'm hoping I don't do that with Liberty.
Yeah.
You know, but I mean, like, my wife and I did, you know, a kink podcast where we had sex and recorded it every week for 184 weeks. You know, we'd have sex and then we'd talk about it and talk about everything afterwards. Yeah, I mean, that was like my inkling of politics way before I got a gun. Me saying, I don't care if the government taps my phone or listens to my emails, reads my emails. They're keeping us safe. And my wife looked at me like, what the fuck are you saying? And said that and explained why. And we even had, you know, Mahoney as a character playing a dumb statist guy, which he's not. He's a smart, funny, you know, smart guy. But we had him playing a dumb statist saying that line that came out of my mouth 5 years ago, you know, and then the government destroying him in the movie. And him, I think he says it after the government destroys him, which is really...
Do we have the government destroy him? I thought we... Oh, yeah, the government destroys him, but also his head explodes.
Yeah, well, he gets his business destroyed by the government, but he's still statist. And he's like, when The Greek chorus girl, Jay Tizzle, says, we don't need the government. We need free markets and free men. And he goes, but, and his head explodes. But the fact that he's still putting up for statism after the state destroys his business that he's built, to me, is kind of indicative of like how dumb a lot of statists, especially liberals, are, but both sides, of backing the government after it's destroying all that's good.
Well, the thing is, people blame themselves. When the state comes down on them, they say something, oh, well, you know, like if it's a traffic warrant thing, they're like, oh, well, I shouldn't have been speeding. I should have gone to court and paid my money. Bad me. You know, not, oh my God, how ridiculous is it that these people are trying to extract money out of me and I didn't hurt anybody? That, you know, people blame themselves, and I do really blame horizontal enforcement, because you watch TV and they show you what the conventional wisdom says is wrong, and so people have, they already have the rhetoric built into their heads of what is wrong, even though morally it's not. And so it's an easy leap for them to say, it was my bad, it's not the state being violent, it's not the state aggressing against me, it's I did the crime, I gotta do the time. Oh well.
Yeah.
But you said that you had a way to bring this back from the dark side to wrap it up. We usually try to have some type of happy ending. What's your happy ending here, Michael?
Well, my happy ending is, for instance, when I was in the band Bomb, I thought I would die before that band, you know, broke up. And I really wanted, like, people to have my albums and have my music to live on. This is way before the internet. I was actually into people cassette copying our record and sharing it with friends, our records, because it would spread it.
Yeah. You know,
I was anti-IP before I even knew what it was. And then I got sober and I wrote this book and I published 1,000 of them. I took it to a printer and had them print it. And as soon as I figured out, oh, you can make a PDF and share it on the internet too, I did that because I wanted it to live after I died. And when I was doing this kink podcast with my wife, I gave her instructions like, okay, if I die, here's where you send the money to DreamHost to keep the website up.
Yeah.
And I did the same thing with every other piece of art I've done. Like, I provided for, if I die, someone will keep this on the internet. The interesting thing is, recently, like, I let that domain expire. I let the Bomb domain expire. And it's like, I'm looking at things in less of terms of this has to live forever and more in, like, this is important now, but it's really chalk on the sidewalk. And I've kind of gotten over the feeling of I must live on. I mean, I basically feel like at age 47, I've done everything I need to do and I could die happy right now. And I've still lived, I've had higher highs and lower lows than most people will ever have. And I've, you know, I talk about being a homebody, but I've toured Europe. I've been to every major city in America and played my music there and done the same thing in the capitals of Europe. Mm-hmm. You know, I've had 10,000 fans with my band Bomb, and now we have more fans than that with what we're doing now, and most of them aren't even the same fans. And we've reached people and we're reaching people. And even though I feel like I could die today, right now, this moment, and have lived a wonderful life and be satisfied with it, which you're not at yet.
No.
You're younger and you're not there yet. Then that's the thing I'm saying about the discrepancy in our age.
Yeah.
I don't want to have kids. I've lived my life. The only reason I'm still alive is because I have someone that loves me. And if she died, I probably wouldn't give up and stop eating and die or put my revolver in my mouth. No, I'd find more reasons to live. But right now, I could die happy. But every day I wake up, I jump out of bed, I drink coffee, and I'm like, how can I reach the world more?
Yeah.
So I guess that's my moral in this story, is I was ready to die 17 years ago, but I still get up every day and do it and am excited about it to reach the world.
Yeah, good deal. I hope you stay alive, Michael. We need to keep pimping this, keep serving the fiends, and hopefully the fiends will feel the same way as we do.
I mean, you're one of my reasons to live too, and no homo, but I've done a lot of art on my own in a lot of mediums. I've done stuff that I've self-published. I've done stuff that I've done on small indie labels, and I've done stuff on major labels, in everything, in music, in books, in filmmaking. You know, in filmmaking, I've worked with Robert Downey Jr., and I also make YouTube videos like everyone else and just put them up on a whim.
Yeah.
I've been on Warner Brothers, and I've been on indie labels, and I've done stuff with you and just put it out ourselves. We got distribution for stuff. Like, I've done all three levels of all three things, of writing, filmmaking, music, and now podcasting. Now, you know, we're on radio now, too. So I've done it all with a whole bunch of different people, like with bands, with collaborators, with writing, with all kinds of people. And you're the person that I work the best with and never scream at and never want to scream at.
Aw, I feel that way, too, Michael. We're partners in freedom here, not partners in crime. Although the state would have us think that it's thought crime. Them.
And that's a lesson I get from Ron Paul, too, and I've gotten from a few other people, like Hubert Selby, interviewing him and studying him before he died. The real lesson is, like, it is about something bigger than you. Like, Ron Paul isn't fighting to get Ron Paul elected.
No.
Every other politician I've ever met is fighting for that politician.
Yep.
Ron Paul is fighting for liberty, and Ron Paul knows, regardless of if he wins, and I kind of don't think he will. I don't want to say he's unelectable because I made a promise not to do that, but I don't think he's going to win. I think some whore, you know, either Romney or Obama, who are equally bad, are probably going to be our president for the next 4 years. But the fucking seed is planted, and there are 5 million more constitutionalists now than there were 5 years ago because of Ron Paul. And
at least a few million more anarchists because of Ron Paul.
Yeah, constitutionalists turn into anarchists. So he has lit a prairie fire under the world. And it's the world. I mean, this interview with Robin that you did, I'm looking, it's getting massive downloads, and like half of them are not from America. You know, there are Ron Paul fans everywhere, which is really liberty fans everywhere. You know, the Arab Spring was nothing. The Arab Spring was trading one tyrant for another. But the Ron Paul Revolution is something that's going to live on in liberty way after Ron Paul's dead.
Amen, brother.
All right.
Keep fighting for freedom. That's the lesson.
Worms.
Peace.
I don't want to die.
Say, go to heaven for all the Sage presiding in the case of the people versus the police department. Prosecuting attorneys are Toby Wright, Jassiri X, and B. Dolan. Order, order, order. B. Dolan, take the stand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
You goddamn right.
Don't want you tell everyone what they have the right to do. Film the police, run a tape for the underclass. Get the face, name, and number on the badge. They flash, we flash back when they act. Disorderly, react accordingly and capture order we see. Nightsticks, zip ties, and tasers. Think your license for tight vicious behavior. Make a tight fist with the video traitor. The pig like this, he dripping, you make him blame us. Explain to a judge the bounds you overstepping. 2011, time to change our method. We aiming lenses like a state's weapon. Today, remember whose goddamn streets they're protecting. Yeah, they rather see me in a cell than me in my cell with a different story to tell. Can't pull up out of dash next time you get stopped. Reach for the celly if you wanna shoot a cop. On the public sidewalk, you could take what you see. A film from your window with the view of the street. Neighborhood crime watch, we police the police. They can't arrest the whole community because the streets clock these cops occupying blocks, harassing the homeless with batons and pulling glocks. They stop low for protests and let off shots. Abuse prostitutes and misuse power they got. In memory of the victims who were never forgot. We gotta exercise our right to shed light in the dark. There is an army on the march, it doesn't want you to watch. You got a weapon in your pocket, whether you know it or not. We the people are the only real media we got. Let's protect one another from the goon squad. Fascism's coming to the USA. Ayo, Sage, I got something to say. Film the police. 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 Film the police.
Police, it's time to make it our priority. You see these fools are an abuse of their authority. You crack a fist or you crack a whip, but that ain't power, you coward. You beat a man with two shackle wrists. So put their names up on a list next to an asterisk. Next time you see them blast a clip, then you flash a flick. Attach a video and pick to your master list. Be on the news at 6, YouTube views legit. The cops watch us, so we gotta have the cop watches. Been a fear law so long, so now it's not awkward. But what is law when it's wrong, when you slam us on the floor? No, this ain't world wrestling entertainment raw. This edutainment, y'all got a call from B. Dolan. You try to squad with Johnny Long, get your meat swollen. Why you think Bobby and Huey P were heat holding? You better load the footage up and get to keystroking. And while you at it, send one off to the administration. It's indicating all the physical intimidation. It's been too long, they said to bear with us. That's why I run up on your caravan and rip off all your dare stickers. This here's near hitless with it and some mere tickets. You feel privileged till your wife get a brassiere lifted. You disappear quick as hopper if you piss a copper off until you get a Channel 7 News helicopter. Violence hides in a cold silence. Tyrants hiding in alliance, quiet or be left somewhere, swept inside. It's Goliath versus a bigger giant. Got us pulling over so far, we ran a curve and hit a hydrant. It's systematic how the system has it. Symptoms of the democratic law that's been flawed since the pilgrims landed. So now tell me what you gonna do. Next time you see the boys in blue, you cock your camera back and point and shoot.
Film the police. 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 The police. Film the police. Film the police.
Police, I got the cannon 70, highest definition for when they try and arrest and lynch them. Then lie and protest the whipping. I serve and protect their victims. They murderers, threats, and hitmen. Observe them and let the witness be the iPhone. Never let bygones be bygones. Get your flip cam before they get in the whipping ride on. It's vital, cause our survival could depend on the video going viral with more viewers than American Idol. Instead of having to bury a child who a cop shot cause they thought he carried a rifle. Them same cops will go to court and swear on the Bible and smile to show the teeth that they preparing to lie through. Whether Crips or Pyro, fight scores and gangsta disciple. Make sure your camera lens gets an eye full. And they liable to try and confiscate it. Better hold on to that shh like you constipated. Cause don't pretend them injuries were not related. Like when we arrived, we saw them dive head first off the pavement. So keep the minicam stashed in the dash of your minivan. Cause they'll flash and smash on any man. Pull out your Blackberry. Cause cops will take a shot at your Blackberry till they see another Blackberry. Don't act scary cause they'll empty the gat on you. Then stand over your body just to sprinkle the crack on your police attack. And you're
don't wanna see their reflections like Dracula, but cameras capture. You're too busy using your flashlights to back to us to notice John Singleton was my passenger. So point, click, and shoot they asses. It's the only way to get the real truth to the masses. Just serious, I'm making movies like Spike Lee. I won't be a Law and Order special victim like Ice-T.
Film the police. Film the police. Film the police.
Freedom Fiends Podcast is covered by a Creative Commons Attribution Sharealike 3.0 license. Do what you want with it and spread it around. Tell two friends. Make copies. Email it to everyone you know. Go on the site and comment. This is a conversation. Every week, we'll have an exciting new episode where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi weave their own unique take on the way the world works and how to find your place in it. Available from freedomfeens.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by Alterati.com, the Micro Effect Radio Network at themicroeffect.com, and the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
Subscribe and tell two friends.
And remember, the only power they have is the power you allow them.